Hello, welcome to this updated presentation on sociological theories of criminality. In this PowerPoint, I'm going to be looking at interactionism and particularly Howard Becker's labelling theory, and then we're going to evaluate how effective it is. Now, I'm updating this, adding a few extra slides and changing a few things around. And in the following slides, when I recorded this last time, it's Christmas. So enjoy the Christmas tree in the back, whether or not it's Christmas time or not. And enjoy the change of clothes as well. Without further ado, let's crack on. So just to remind you, sociological theories of crime are saying that social factors play a role in crime. They generally assume that a disadvantaged social class is the cause of crime, and that's largely due to unfavourable conditions such as unemployment, single parent families, etc. So as I said, we're going to look at interactionism and in particular labelling theory in this presentation. And interactionism sees our interactions with one another as being based on meanings or labels. Now I'm going to explain this in a bit more detail as we go along. So for example, criminal is a label that some people, such as police officers, may attach to others, such as for example, young males, as in my picture here, in their interactions with one another. So crime and criminals, interactionists would say, are social constructs. They're meanings that we create through our social interactions. So it really starts, I suppose, with this man here, Howard Becker. We'll look at him in more detail when we look at Unit 4. But briefly, he said in his important book, The Outsiders, that social groups create deviance by creating the rules whose breaking constitutes deviance, and by applying those rules to particular people and labelling them as outsiders. So what Becker's doing here is putting forward the argument that crime is subjective. It's a subjective concept. Agencies or agents of social control, such as the police and judges, what they do is they label certain acts as deviant or criminal, and the behaviour will then be punished accordingly. So crime is a social construct. So this moves us on to the idea of labelling and the self-fulfilling prophecy. Edwin Lamert says that labelling is a cause of crime and deviance. And he says by labelling certain people as deviant, society encourages them to become more so, so more deviant. You label someone, they create that, they become more deviant. So he explains this by distinguishing between primary and secondary deviance. Now, for the purposes of the exam, you have to understand the difference between primary and secondary deviance. So let's start with primary deviance. So primary deviance is defined as a deviant act that's not been publicly labelled is often trivial. It goes mostly uncaught. A norm is broken, but mostly the breaking of the norm is tolerated or concealed by others within society. So examples of this might be things like queue dodging, not paying for the fare on a bus, or downloading music illegally, or teenage drinking underage, or maybe teenagers smoking underage, or littering, for example, or perhaps shoplifting to a certain extent. So it's that idea that these are trivial crimes, mostly don't get punished, and they're sort of tolerated, or if they go on, people don't really talk much about it. So that's primary deviance. When we get through to secondary deviance, that's a bit more severe. And that, it's argued, is results from labelling. So people treat the offender solely in terms of his or her label, which then becomes his or her master status, which can then lead to a self-fulfilling prophecy. Now these phrases here, master status and self-fulfilling prophecy, are important, need to be able to use them if you're talking about labelling theory. So master status is defined as the status that plays the greatest role in shaping a person's life and determining their social identity. So, for instance, the individual is seen as, say, a thief, because that's their master status, but that overrides all their other statuses, which might be mother or churchgoer or workmate or whatever. But they are labelled as a thief. That's what they become. That's their master status. So here's a classic example of labelling here from America. I'm a thief. I stole from Walmart. This is an example of some punishments that are handed out in America where you publicly shame people. Or this one. I stole from a nine-year-old on her birthday. Don't steal or this could happen to you. So you get the idea. So they're labelled as thieves. So self-fulfilling prophecy is the idea that we become what people expect us to become. And so if we're negatively labelled a certain way by others, we become that label. So to give you an example, you know, I wear a hoodie and obey the law. But the police think I'm in a gang because I wear a hoodie and therefore they keep stopping and searching me. So therefore, because this happens all the time, if that's how I'm labelled, that I'm joining a gang as I'm sick of it. You've created from a law-abiding citizen through the constant harassment of labelling someone, they then become the very thing that they've been labelled. That is the idea, the concept of a self-fulfilling prophecy. Hopefully that makes sense. So, as a result of secondary deviance labelling, the offender can be rejected by society and forced into the company of other criminals, which means they're joining a deviant subculture. And a classic example of this is prison, because the offender is taken out of normal society, placed with others who then, because they are criminal as well, confirm his or her criminal identity. They provide him or her with criminal role models and they teach him or her criminal skills. Now, this quote here from Peter Kropotkin, prisons are universities of crime maintained by the state. And this is, you know, the self-fulfilling prophecy. It's become complete. The individual has now become the label that we said that they were. And so the result is that further offending, recidivism, becomes more likely. And this then leads us through to the deviance amplification spiral. And this, I'm going to give you a diagram of this so it should make sense, is the idea where any attempt to control deviance through a crackdown leads to an increasing rather than a decreasing of that deviance. So, you know, these sort of headlines are linked to it. Okay. So you have a crackdown. And actually, let's say you're cracking down on knife crime, and actually all your crackdown does is lead to more knife crime, because it promotes even greater attempts to control it, and in turn, yet more deviance happens in an escalating spiral. So this is why it's called the deviance amplification spiral. And you can have a look at this very nice idea of this on YouTube. So we'll have a look at this on labelling. This clip here is well worth a look. Nice little 5-minute clip on it. So if you're watching on my YouTube channel, you'll just have to jot down the link, but it's well worth a look. So let's look at this deviance amplification spiral. Here's our spiral. So to give an idea of how crackdowns lead to more deviance, this is what interactionists would say, labeling theorists would say. So there's my deviance, the amplification spiral. So we get a social reaction to the deviance. Society reacts to the deviance within society. And in turn, as a result of that, we get isolation. The deviant group feel isolated from society. Society is saying they're deviant. They start to feel they're not part of society. Therefore, they're isolated. So that then leads to resistance to society, fighting back. So they resist the social reaction. They're not happy with the way society is treating them. That in turn then leads, because they're resisting, to more deviance, because resistance leads to it. Then in turn, society tries to control the deviants. So governments attempt to control the deviant behaviour, they bring in new laws. And as a result of that, this results in, because of new laws, further behaviours being labelled as immoral or deviant, which then in turn leads to moral panic. This idea that society, government identify as being, that, you know, society and government are in danger, in moral danger, due to the behaviour of certain groups and their behaviour. And we'll look at this in a little more detail as we go into this PowerPoint. In turn, that leads to deviance because the behaviour is labelled as deviant. Then the media get into it and then they report on the deviants and they identify them as a threat to society. So this is the phrase known as a folk devil. You should have covered this in Unit 1, but I'll be looking back to this in a minute. And of course, the media bung it out on the press, and that then leads to a social reaction to the deviants, and so on and so forth, and the spiral keeps going. So more and more deviance is created by the attempt to crack it down. Hopefully that makes sense, but you can go back and look at this at your leisure. So if we want to have a look at the deviance amplification spiral, we can look at a case study of the Mods and Rockers in the 1960s. And this is mentioned also in Unit 1. So Stan Cohen, Folk Devils and Moral Panics was his work. It was a study of the Mods and Rockers in 1964. And this panic where wild ones invade Seaside, 97 arrests. This is from the original alleged incident in Clacton in 64. And Cohen found that the whole panic about mods versus rockers in the 60s was started by one small fight in Clacton. And because this fight involved two clearly distinguishable groups, mods dressed smartly in suits on their scooters and rockers in leathers on their motorbikes, the media then took it on board and distorted the events. And they claimed that the two groups had gone there deliberately to fight, which was not the case. And there therefore followed lots of articles and interviews in the media, which led to many of the British youth then identifying with one group or the other. And I would thoroughly recommend you having a look at this quick clip, which identifies the whole problem. So you can see, if you look at the interviews with the Mods and the Rockers, how the press are fueling that moral panic. They ask things like, well, where do you think the next fight will be? And the mod replies, well, I think it will probably be Whit, probably in Brighton. So that self-fulfilling prophecy is happening as we look, as we speak. So, as I said, the reports of the media then have an influence on the magistrates and the police. That in turn led to more arrests. That led to stiffer sentencing. And according to Cohen, this wasn't because there was more trouble. It was simply because the police were more likely to arrest youths who either fitted the stereotype of mod or the stereotype of rocker, because they've been labelled as troublemakers. They've been labelled as clearly going there for a fight. And so there you are, the police are then arresting them because they are labelled, they're stereotypes. They may not have done anything wrong, but because they're then being arrested, so and so, the spiral continues. So this is what Cohen calls deviancy amplification. The idea that events are distorted and the labelling by the media of a group of youths as troublemakers, folk devils for want of a better word, creates a stereotype image which is then held by the police and the public, which then means that they react more forcibly against a perceived threat to law and order. And there's your example of moral panic. So moral panic is a condition, an episode, a personal group that emerges and becomes defined as a threat to society's values and interests. Often stylized by stereotypical fashion, in stereotypical fashion by the mass media. You know, it's mods, it's rockers, it's terrorists, whatever. You know, hoodies, for want of a better word, would be a good example there. So another case study you could look at is the hippies early 70s here, Young study in 71 of hippie cannabis users found another amplification spiral in there, similar to the amplification spiral with mods and rockers. Initially, drug use was not central to the hippie's lifestyle and actually went undetected by law. So there's your example of primary deviance, something that's a little deviant but no one really cares about. However, increased police attention started to label them as addicts, and they had raids and arrests, etc., which then led them to retreat into their own closed groups, where they then developed a deviant subculture where hard drug use was a central activity. So again, what we see is the central is the self-fulfilling prophecy in action. Now, I'll give you some examples of deviancy amplification spiral, of folk devils, of self-fulfilling prophecies. Just a quick word on interactionism and crime statistics. Now, interestingly, interactionists reject the use of crime statistics compiled by the police. And they do that because they argue that the statistics measure what the police do rather than what criminals do. So, for instance, if the police stereotype working class males as typical criminals, what they'll do is they'll spend more time pursuing this group than, let's say, middle class white collar criminals. So as a result, the statistics will be full of working class males purely because of the police's stereotypes that crime is committed by them. So therefore, their statistics are a social construction and not a true measure of crime. Hopefully that makes sense. So let's evaluate labelling theory. So what are its strengths? Well, it shows that the law is not a fixed set of rules to be taken for granted, but something whose construction we need to explain, and that's a good thing. And it shifts the focus onto how the police create crime by applying labels based on their stereotypes of a typical criminal. So this selective law enforcement may explain why working class and minority groups are overrepresented in crime statistics. And it also shows how attempts to control deviance can trigger deviance amplification spiral and therefore more deviance. And so in our final slide, let's look at the limitations here of labelling theory. Firstly, I think you can argue that it fails to explain why people commit primary deviance in the first place, because they commit that before they're labelled. So in a sense, that doesn't quite work out. So have a think about that. Secondly, by assuming that offenders are passive victims of labelling, it ignores the fact that, you know, some people, some individuals may also actively choose to be deviant. It's not a result of their labelling, it's the fact they choose to be deviant. Also, it ignores the victim of crime and focuses on the criminal instead. And so that leads to a potential to actually romanticise crime. And finally, the theory in itself is very deterministic. So as soon as one person is labelled, it would argue that a deviant character is inevitable. So once you're labelled, you'll become deviant. And we know that's not the case. Not all people that are labelled become that deviant label that they've been given. Some choose to ignore what people are saying. So there are your weaknesses. I hope you found that informative, and I'll see you for my next PowerPoint. Take care and goodbye.